Hey, everybody. This is an exterior door frame, and it's weather-beaten. The paint is flaking off, and in this video, I need to scrape off the paint that is loose and then repaint. And I thought I would talk about the history of house paint while I do this chore. Yeah, the paint, it's not too bad. This would be a pretty easy chore. And I'll use these tools. Some paint, paint scraper, a wire brush, a stirring stick, and I have an assortment of paintbrushes. This particular paint scraper has a carbide blade. There are other types of scrapers, and I do have a couple of other ones, but this one I like. It's comfortable to hold and it does a good job. So we'll just knock off the paint that is kind of barely hanging on. Any paint that does not come off, well, I'll just paint right over that. In prehistoric times, you know, like the cavemen, they used paint. It was made from animal fat. And they added like soot or dirt to it, and they decorated the walls of their caves. It's a natural instinct for man to want to make his dwelling as nice as possible. The ancient Egyptians, well, they used animal fat as a base, and they added ground glass or semi-precious stones or lead and dirt and even animal blood to make paint. We skip forward a few centuries and we find that English house painters, at that point, they had formed guilds, or kind of like unions, I guess, to protect their trade secrets and standardize their craft. A few centuries later, in the 1600s, painting had come a long way since the Egyptians. New processes and technologies revolutionized house paint. And of course, that found its house paint found its way across the Atlantic Ocean to the American colonies. And in the early days of the colonies, painting your house opened a person up to some serious social disapproval. And it was because of the pilgrims in their puritanical beliefs that this happened, because they thought a colorful home expressed vanity or an excess of happiness. That's just crazy. And I read that there is a preacher in the Charleston colony that painted the inside of his house in 1630. And because of that, he was accused of sacrilege, which I understand was an actual crime during that time. So it was basically illegal to paint your house. It's looking pretty good. So, of course, making something illegal only increases demand for it. And so a black market, I guess there was more than one, but black market paint recipe books began to circulate. And these books taught people how to make their own paint. Contained in the books was advice like using lime and ground oyster shells to make a whitewash, and then adding iron oxide if you wanted red, or copper oxide added to the whitewash to get a nice green color. And it talked about using other ingredients in your homemade paint, like milk or egg whites, coffee, or even rice. It's important that you really stir your paint completely before you use it. In the years between 1600 and 1800, that most house paint used either oil or water as a base. And it was dependent upon color, because some colors worked better in oil, while others worked better in water. And painters tended to use water-based paints on ceilings and plaster walls, and oil paint was best for decorating woodwork. And that's in many cases still true today. There's a letter A. Let's see what else I can make. How do you like that? To get the pigments to mix as fully as possible into an oil base, it was necessary to grind white lead powder by hand in the 1700s. And, well, you guessed it, many painters became afflicted with lead poisoning. But lead paint was popular because it was durable and it was able to retain color without fading. Thankfully, machines were eventually invented to do that dangerous work of grinding the lead powder. Lead paint, as good as it was eventually outlawed in the U.S., but it took until 1978, believe it or not. This is kind of fun. By the mid-1800s, linseed oil began to be used as a less expensive binding agent, and it actually protected the wood that was painted using it. Also in the 1800s, paint mills were steam powered, so production went up because of that, and making paint in large quantities was easier than ever. And that's when the big paint companies came about, because in 1866, Sherwin-Williams, which would eventually become one of the largest global paint makers, opened for business. In a few years after that, in 1873, co-founder Henry Sherwin came up with a resealable tin can, much like the one you see here, I imagine. Benjamin Moore began selling paint in 1883. Okay, that's stirred up pretty good. It's time to pour some paint into a container and start painting. During World War II, linseed oil became kind of scarce. And because of this linseed oil shortage, chemists mixed alcohols and acids to make artificial resins to be used instead of linseed oil. So these were synthetic oils. And they were cheap to make and lasted a long time, so they quickly replaced oil as a paint. Let's clean the top of the can before I put the lid on. So, you know, just like any other consumer product, house paint has gone through many, many changes since it was, since man started, you know, putting stuff on walls to decorate, you know, since paint first came about. But its primary purpose has always remained the same, which is to add color and joy to our everyday lives. So perhaps you have a simple painting project like this that you've been neglecting, I urge you to, you know, if you've got the time, you know, take care of it. Take care of your stuff. You have an investment. So invest some time to try to keep it looking presentable, not only for you, but for your family, for your neighbors. You know, don't let your house be the one in the neighborhood that everybody cringes at when they drive by. You have to do your chores. You can't put things off forever. Or there will be consequences for doing so. And you may not even realize it, so. It's best just to do your chores as they present themselves. This was an easy chore, and it looks like it came out pretty good. I'm pretty happy with it. It'll last for a few years, I hope.